Good morning, everyone. Merry Christmas, a little early. Good to see all of you. I'm Jake Waybright, one of the pastors here, and it's great to be together this Christmas Eve morning for worship this morning. Whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us online, we are glad that you are with us. If you're visiting us for the first time, welcome to Carlisle United Methodist Church, where all are invited to come and to live, to strive together to live like Jesus, and all means all. We are glad that you are here and that you chose to come and to celebrate the birth of Christ as we celebrate this Christmas Eve together here at our church. If you're here joining us online or in person, we'd love to have you sign in and let us know that you are worshiping with us. If you're online, you can scan this QR code and let us know that you are here and sign on online. If you're here in person, in front of you in the chairs, there is a little black book. We invite you to pull that out, sign in, pass it down, pass it back. It's also a way you can get to know the names of some of the other folks in your row there on the chair next to you. Also, just a few things as we come into worship today. Today is a communion service. This is our Christmas Eve communion service. If you're joining us online today, you are more than welcome to join us in sharing in that communion. You'll just want to have some kind of a bread or a cracker or a juice or water next to you to be ready to share in communion with us at that part of the service. Now, today we have a lot of services. The birth of Christ is kind of a big deal, right? And so tonight we have three candlelight services. Those services will be where we'll sing Silent Night and light candles together as we remember that our light has come. The 4:30 service, which will be our kids and family service with our children's choir singing and a special kids chat for our kids. Our 7 o'clock contemporary, and our 9 o'clock traditional, where our choir and we'll be sharing a lot of special music. And so you're welcome to come back to join here or to join us on live stream for any of those services. Also, a reminder, next Sunday, we are back to our normal Sunday morning worship schedule, 8, 9:45, and 11:15, get ready to ring in your new year as you come. And as Pastor Mira once again shares a message as she did last year as we go into the new year of finding a star word to guide your way into the new year. So I hope you plan on joining us next Sunday in person or online. Well, as we come into worship today, I want to invite you to join me in our opening prayer as we see it on the screen. Would you stand as you are able? God, we journey with you to Bethlehem's stable and a newborn king, ears attuned to the songs of angels, eyes alert for Bethlehem's star. Forgive us if on our journey, if we are distracted by this world, keep our hearts aflame with the hope of Christmas and the promise of a Savior. Amen. Our opening hymn, There's a Song in the Air. Let's join together, number 249.
Thank you.
seated, and we're going to continue in worship then as you're seated with the lighting of the Advent candle. And as you're seated, Bill and Phyllis Spengler are going to light our Advent wreath for this fourth Sunday of Advent.
The Apostle Paul writes that we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord. For it is the God who said, "Light will shine out of darkness." Who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ? Throughout our Advent journey, we have heard the message of John, who came to testify to the light.
We welcome and receive Christ with joy and gladness, and we commit ourselves to reflecting the light and love that he brings into the world. Today, as we light the candles of hope, peace, and joy, and add the fourth candle, the candle of love, we also leave one unlit candle next to the candle of peace as we pray for peace for our sisters and brothers in Bethlehem. Please join us in the prayer, the words for which will be shown on the screen. Risen Christ, light of the world, shine in our lives and shine among us now. Prepare our hearts to receive the light of your love and to be witnesses of that light to others.
I now invite the kids to come up for the kids' message. Grace, you're it, but I recruited another helper for you. Hey, guys. What's up? So you were both here for last service, but we also know there's some friends online, so we still like to do this. But I'm going to change it up and make it harder because you're older, okay? So, last service, I pointed to something and said, you tell me what I'm pointing, tell me two things about it, right? This time we're going to do kind of the, I'm going to tell you two things about something and you have to guess what I'm telling, what I'm thinking of. So I'm going to sit over here. It's somewhere up here. It's red and it has a black speck on it. A cardinal. Ooh, good. Okay. Somewhere out there. It's black. And I'm working on a second thought. And it, what? Shoot. Okay, let's try again. Lincoln, it's your turn. It's out there, and it has some yellow, and it tells the pastors a really important message. The flame. Do you know what the message is it tells us? We're now live. So when we see that, we have to remember people online are watching. Yes. Okay, last one. It is on the stage. It's black with some white. The drums. Good job. It's like you guys have been here for a while. Well, you have, right? Yeah. So what am I doing? I'm telling you about some objects, right? And how does that relate to the story of the sermon? Because you've heard it once. Yeah, you decrease and I increase. It's the message of, John the Baptist. He was a really good friend of Jesus, and he pointed out things about Jesus to other people. So he did kind of like what I did. He said, let's look at this. He told people to look at what Jesus was doing, And then he said, hey, you need to pay attention to Jesus more than you pay attention to anybody else. That's really the message of Christmas, is as Jesus comes, we want to remember to pay attention more to him than to anything else. And then we try to live like Jesus, not like other people or people that are friends or other people. We want to try and do our best to live like Jesus. Cool. Thanks for coming up, guys. Can you say a prayer with me? Dear God, thank you for Jesus and the ways in which we can live like him. Thank you for his birth and all his love. Amen. Okay, thanks for coming. You can each take a handful. It's all good. Thanks, guys.
Well, as we continue in worship, I just want to thank all of you for your generosity as we come to the end of the year. You remember that the end of the year, many of you kind of decide to make year-end gifts towards the ministers of the church, and we are incredibly grateful for your generosity here at the end of the year and throughout the year. A reminder, you can give in several different ways that are on the screen, and it is your year-end gifts that often put us across that finish line for our budget for the year end. And so thank you for thinking of us here at the end of the year. Also, on the end of the year, as we come towards Christmas, we like to make opportunities for us to give to people who, to give the money away to people in need. A reminder that our Christmas Eve offering, if you designated offering as the Christmas Eve offering today or this evening, our Christmas Eve offering is going to a community serve partner with the United Way with a program called Success by Six. And all that money will go to Success by Six is an early reading program that focuses on preschoolers throughout the Carlisle area, helping them to read. And part of that is that our Little Lights Daycare participates in this program, and part of that is giving a book to all of these young emerging readers. And our Christmas Eve offering this year will go to fund, hopefully, all the books that they need for all of the kids who are in that program in the Carlisle area for the year. So thank you for being a part of that as we continue to make a difference in the lives of those who are hungry and kids and in those struggling to find housing in our community. Also, throughout this Christmas season, we've been inviting you to consider giving a gift as we remember Jesus, the alternative gift as part of our serve ministries that make a difference to those in our community. Today we have Cheryl Hale sharing a little bit how the alternative gift that goes to as part of the refugee team makes a difference in the lives of those in our community. Take a look at Cheryl's message for today.
Good morning, CUMC. My name is Cheryl Hale, and I lead the refugee ministry under our serve pillar. This Advent season, I invite you to support CUMC's alternative gifts. Alternative gifts are opportunities to donate to one or many of the serve partners that we work with here in Carlisle and beyond. Gifts can be given in memory of or honor of friends and loved ones. In our refugee ministry, our alternative gift this year is $10 to buy paper products. When refugees arrive here, the people that we support oftentimes have very, very little. They come with usually the clothes on their backs and a few other things. They do receive some financial support to help them get started, and they also receive food stamps, but that doesn't usually buy everything that they need. We have many that have young children that may need diapers, and we also have needs for things like tissues, toilet paper, paper towels, and other gifts that food stamps won't buy. Your alternative gift will help them to stretch their incomes and to be able to provide for their families. I hope you'll consider purchasing an alternative gift in my program or another that touches your heart and supports our serve partners. Brochures are available in the gathering and online. Please return gift orders by December 24th so that we can bless our partners. Thank you for all you give at CUMC that make a difference in our community.
Thank you for your generosity throughout the year at this Christmas season. And we always pray that our generosity and our giving, whether it be to the ministries of the church or to share the love of Christ with others in the community, is to the glory of God. And so I want to invite you to stand as you're able as we dedicate our gifts and our generosity to God through the singing of the doxology.
Thank you.
God, we thank you for the opportunity to be generous. And on this this Christmas Eve, as we remember the generosity that you gave your son to us, to come and to be one of us, to share your love that we might be one with you, we pray, God, that you would accept our gifts that we offer for the ministry of the church and to make a difference in the lives of others in this community and beyond. We pray that you would accept them and that you would use them to your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you may be seated. We continue now in worship by lifting up prayers for our community and for our world. In your bulletin, you'll see that there are prayer concerns listed for folks in our congregation who are in need of prayer. Also, one addition this week, Daryl Clepper is in the hospital, is back in the hospital, and so we just lift up Daryl and his family today as well. As we go to prayer today, we remember that that it is God who is the source of our rock and our salvation. Let us go to God in a time of prayer. God of hope, peace, joy, and love, we thank you for these candles that we light that remind us that hope, peace, joy, and love come from you. As we wait, we make these candles our prayers as well. This morning, as we come, as we've lit the candle of hope, we pray for all people everywhere and anywhere who are feeling hopeless today. For those who are needing a glimmer of hope to move them forward, we pray, God, that this Christmas, that the gift of your Son Jesus and his Spirit that lives with us would strengthen and encourage them to have hope for tomorrow. We pray particularly for those in our congregation who are in recovery or who are going through illness. We pray, God, that you would help to keep their spirit strong and to help their hope to be firmly anchored in the future. We pray for Earl Keller, for Dee Delp, for Dorothy Reibel, for Doris Lay, and for Daryl Clepper. We pray for each of them this day, God, that the hope of Christ may give them hope today. God, as we have lit the candle of peace, we pray for peace. We pray for all who mourn this day, particularly those in our congregation who have lost loved ones. We remember the family of Howard Kerstetter, of Earl Sugart, of Sue Lebo on the death of her mother, Clara McCoy, and Bill Spangler on the death of his uncle, Bob. We pray, God, that your peace may descend and abide with them, that they might find strength from day to day, and as in the comfort of your presence and your love come to be with us. God, as we have lit the candles of peace, we also pray for peace around the world. We pray and remember the victims of violence around the world. In particular, on this Christmas, we hold the people of Ukraine and of Israel and Palestine in our hearts and in our prayers. God, we pray for peaceful resolution. And we pray, God, for the end of needless suffering. God, we pray for peace in our world. And God, today, as we have lit the candle of joy, we also come to pray for those whose hearts are heavy and weighed down by sorrow. We pray, God, that in the midst of this season, that they might find the light of joy, the promise of joy that comes with the birth of Christ. And finally, God, as we have lit the candle of love, we pray that your love may be known in the hearts and the lives of ourselves and of those around the world. We pray for those who do not feel loved, and we pray for those who struggle to love others. God, we pray these things in eager expectation of the revelation of the Son of God. And we pray that the peace and love, joy, and hope that his presence brings may be known to us. As the song says, how silently this wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessing of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Lord enters in. May this be reality for us as we wait and pray together now the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We continue now in worship with an anthem from our combined choir.
Connie, choir, thank you. Beautiful piece. Appreciate that. Thank you. Well, good morning and Merry Christmas. Each gospel has a different telling of Jesus' birth. In John's gospel, we miss the familiar words of Matthew and Luke retelling Jesus' birth with angels and shepherds. Instead, the beginning is outside normal time and in the cosmic start of the world. John then moves quickly to focus of how God is made known to the world through the life and death of Jesus. Hear now the opening of John's Gospel, telling how it all began from John 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. May God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and living of these words. Amen.
Throughout this Advent season, we've been exploring that life of John the Baptist and how he prepared the way for Jesus's life and ministry. The first week in December, Pastor Jake introduced us to John's parents, Zachariah and Elizabeth, who in their senior years become pregnant with a child. Zachariah, whose name means God is faithful, was then unable to speak for the entire 9 months. While Elizabeth, whose name means God of oaths, anticipated caring for this long-awaited child. And through these past couple of weeks, we've seen how God answers and hears our prayers, how silence can help our relationship with God grow, and how repentance can lead to a change of our hearts, our minds, and even our behaviors. Today, on this morning of Christmas Eve, we learn what I think is that most important lesson from John. But before we get there, let's recap a little bit about that relationship between John and Jesus. When Mary first learned she was pregnant, she goes to visit her cousin Elizabeth, who is already a few months pregnant with John. Upon meeting, John leaps in the womb of Elizabeth. And scripture leads us to believe that Mary and Elizabeth were cousins that were close throughout their lives. So their sons, born months apart, John and Jesus, also were probably close, visiting each other on high holy days as they would all travel to Jerusalem. And it's quite possible that even as teens, John and Jesus would discuss scripture, religion, and their understanding and questions about God and life in their world. As they grew, John grew into religious leadership, calling people to repent of their past actions and asking them to make changes in their lives to follow God. That's what Pastor Jake talked about last Sunday. And then as they would agree to make those changes in their lives to repent, John then baptizes people, signifying to them and to the entire community that they are now a new person, because of God's forgiveness and grace. John would take them into the water, go underwater, representing their old lives, and raise them above to the air, having them breathe and fill their lungs with fresh air and new life, being reminded of God's love, of grace and forgiveness filling their lives. So one day, when John and Jesus were about 30 years old, Jesus comes to John, and Jesus says, "John, will you baptize me?" John is like, "No, I don't need to do that. You're Jesus." But somehow, Jesus convinces him, and John baptizes Jesus. We don't know all the details how Jesus convinced him. But why do you think Jesus needed or wanted to be baptized? If baptism shows repentance and our acknowledgement of needing forgiveness, Jesus, God's Son, was perfect. Some scholars say it's because Jesus wants to show us and to remind us again that God is with us. That God is with us when we need to repent. That in needing to ask for forgiveness, that Jesus, God, is with us, just like he comes to live on earth as Emmanuel, God with us. And we're also reminded that as we come up out of that water of baptism, that Jesus joins us in the rising into new lives and to being with us in that future ahead. Looking back, this moment when Jesus is baptized begins and actually marks the public ministry of Jesus. From Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, we hear these words, "Just as he," Jesus, "was coming up out of the waters, Jesus saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending on him like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, 'You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased.'" It's the marking that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is about to begin his ministry that will change the world forever. And it's after this moment that his teaching and healing ministry really starts to increase. And as Jesus' ministry increases, John's ministry starts to decrease. And John is very clear about his role and tells people as they come to the Jordan River, as they want to confess their sins, John says, "The one who is more powerful than I am coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." So fast forward a few months, and John's gospel tells us that the disciples of Jesus, the ones that are learning from him and following him, they actually go to John and say, "John, should we stop Jesus from baptizing? Because baptizing is your thing, John the Baptist." And John's reply was that, "Ever since the beginning, I knew that I was not the Messiah. My job," John says, "is to prepare the way for the Messiah." And John says, "He," meaning Jesus, "must increase, and I must decrease." You see, John was doing the job all along that God had called him to do. He was not to be Jesus. He was to point to Jesus. So John willingly steps out of that spotlight to give Jesus the spotlight. And that's the most important lesson I think we can learn from John's life. To step out of the spotlight and to give Jesus the spotlight. It was my second year in seminary, and I was serving as an intern at a local church, United Methodist Church in New Jersey, as their youth pastor. A few months in, I think it was late fall, and things at the church just started to get crazy. And the senior pastor took an unexpected leave. And the church asked if I would step up and become their pastor until they figured things out. Now, folks, I was 23 years old, right out of college, and really didn't know what I was doing, and faked it less than I do now. And I struggled with how to get involved, how to help out this church that was in a bad situation, and what to do because I wanted to please them and prove myself as a young pastor, but not sure I could really do much. And so one afternoon, I met with coffee for my advisor. She was one of the very few United Methodist clergy at this Presbyterian seminary. She was well-respected, but only had a few mentees due to her writing and travel. So we met for over an hour. She knew this church because she had worked in this area for a while, and she listened to what was going on behind the scenes, worked with me to unravel the mess that was before us, and suggested some steps forward. But then literally, like a light going off, she said, and I will never forget her words, "Mira, they want you to be Jesus, but your job is to point them to Jesus. We need to start this whole conversation over again." John the Baptist said, "He must increase and I must decrease. You aren't the light. Your job is to point to the light." It was that John the Baptist moment that I will never forget. Where in your life or who in your life is trying to make you Jesus when you really need to say, "I can point you to Jesus, but I am not Jesus. I can be a witness to Jesus for you, but I can't be Jesus for you." You see, John was really clear about this. In the scripture that Chris read, we hear these words, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world." This scripture points us back to those first words of John. Those first words of John that I memorized in seminary because I was afraid they would be my final in the Greek exam, and my memorization was a whole heck of a lot better than my translation of Greek. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into him through, came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people." And it ends with these words, "And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth." You see, unlike all the other Gospels, John understood Jesus as part of God from the start of creation. Jesus, the Word of God incarnate, God living among us, God come to life. Or in the words of John Wade in this beloved Christmas hymn, in verse 6, we hear these words. Get to sing the whole song. But from that youngest of ages, John knew that Jesus was God and that Jesus was with us. John knew that his job was not to be the light for the people, but to point the people to that light. For John was a witness to the light, the love, and the life of Jesus. So he pointed people to Jesus. He encouraged the disciples, no, go and follow Jesus. He baptized people, telling them that Jesus would be with them and that Jesus was the way that we could see with our own eyes the love and the grace and the forgiveness of God. So Christmas is our annual reminder that we are not Jesus, but that we are to be like John, and that we are to point to the light and the love of Jesus. Think about the moon. We all love to see it when it is a full moon, but we all know the moon doesn't have light of its own, but it reflects beautifully the light of the sun. And in the same way, we're not called to be the light of Jesus, but to reflect Jesus out into our communities. To reflect the light and the love of Jesus is that live like Jesus part of our motto here at CUMC. So this week, in the conversations around your table, in driving back and forth to family and friends, in shopping and working, how will you reflect the light of Jesus? How will you be like John the Baptist and not try to be the savior for your family or your friends? Not try to be the perfect parent and make everything go just as you planned, but how will you point to Jesus and teach those around you that light and love comes from Jesus? In the words of the Afro-American spiritual, this Christmas may we each strive to do just that. May you do just that. May you be a witness that goes and shares the love and the light of Christ over the mountains, over your community. May you go and point to Jesus. May you go and shine the light of Jesus, because that's the call of John the Baptist. And that's the call of Christmas. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, we give thanks for the call and the life and the love of Christ, and for the example of John the Baptist, that we can point to Jesus. God, help us when sometimes people and even ourselves want to be Jesus. But remind us that our job is to point to him and to love him and to live like him. This Christmas and always. And all of God's people said, amen.
We're going to share now in a service of communion on this Christmas Eve. And, you know, just like John the Baptist pointed to Christ, so this meal in these simple elements of bread and juice point to Christ as well, to his grace, to his love, to his sacrifice for us. And just as John the Baptist invited people to come and receive that grace and that new life and the power of Christ to be forgiven and to make a fresh start every time we come to the communion table, it's an opportunity for us once again to experience that forgiveness and that grace and to make a fresh start again with Christ. And so I invite you to this day to come and to share in this communion table. And there will be some responsive parts of this communion prayer that will be on the screen. Let us join together in blessing this meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
it is right, and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. For you created light out of darkness and brought forth light, life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And in the fullness of time, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. At his birth, the angels sang, "Glory to you in the highest, and peace to your people on earth." And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join together with their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem and found no room, so Jesus went from Galilee to Jerusalem and was despised and rejected. As in poverty of the stable Jesus was born, so by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your word became flesh, born of woman, on that night long ago, so on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to you, and he shared it with his disciples, his friends. And he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you share it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these God's mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim together the great mystery of our faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and of cup. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. We pray this through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
I'm going to invite those that are serving to please come forward as we prepare the table. A reminder that here at CUMC, our table is Christ's table. It is open and all are welcome. So whether you're a member, a guest, whether you haven't been to church in a long time, if you believe in Christ and want to experience his love in your life, we invite you to come forward and to receive. There'll be four stations on the floor. You can see the diagram on the screen. And you'll come and receive a piece of bread, and then you can dip it into the cup. The response often is, "Thanks be to God." And then we invite you to go back to your seat. If you're unable to come forward, those serving will come and serve you in your seat. There's also a gluten-free option available if you need that. In a moment, the table of Christ will be ready, and we invite you to come, to remember that you are loved, and to receive Christ's love into your hearts.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which once again, just as at your birth some 2,000 years ago, you've given yourself for us. We pray this Christmas that you may come and dwell in our hearts. And we pray, God, that we might leave and go about our days as witnesses to your light and your love and your hope. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. You're invited to stand as you are able for our closing hymn. Let's sing together.
Celebration of Christmas joining us this evening. We have three worship services. Just a reminder, if you can put the next slide up. Thank you. 4:30, our family service. 7 o'clock, our contemporary service. 9 o'clock, our traditional service. All of them will be live streamed. So if you are traveling or in other areas this evening, we invite you to join us online. A reminder, after our service, our prayer team's over on the side. It would be happy to pray with you today for anything that touches and tugs at your heart. And may you go this day. May you be reminded of the message of John the Baptist, to be a witness to the light of Christ. And may you go and tell it on the mountain. Go in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And all of us said, amen. See you back here this evening.